Greetings and blessed day to you once again, people of God. It's the Revelator once again. And hoping the grace and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you until the end of time. We meet once again in this mind-blowing series presentation. We are coming from the first segment where I presented the exorcism of God, where it began, where we experienced God being the possessor instead of a demon, and many were left shocked, and only to realize that the same God who cannot be driven out but can drive himself out is the same God who is the deliverer. We explained about many other segments from part 1, part 2, 3, and 4, where different characters emerged, the likes of Job, who was afflicted by God, and all deliverance could only come from God. We focused on the ultimate character, who is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, how he pleaded with the God, and that being God, pleading unto God, when he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, and only the deliverance of that manner could come from God. We explained about Paul going to the church in Ephesus, being given all the power, being equipped by God to deliver them, giving them the word, not only giving them the word, laying hands upon them, and they received the Holy Spirit. But afterwards, they were hardened by the same God. And God, being the possessor, God behind the afflictions, God behind the persecutions, the exorcism of God being impossible, but the exorcism of God again being possible through the hand of God. We want to enter into the fifth segment, which is now going to be part 5, the exorcism of God. And I'm hoping that those that have been following from part 1, you are following, listening attentively and learning that only God is the ultimate deliverer, and learning that there is a level where God can only be the deliverer, and that level is the level that the same God can also possess you, can also be behind those same afflictions that you're pleading unto the same Lord to deliver you. The exorcism of God, part 5, God versus God. God versus God. But whenever you hear me saying God versus God, it means those gods will have to be defined so that it can yield an interpretation that gives birth to a certain understanding at the end of the day. The exorcism of God, part 5. Let us get into scriptures. Luke chapter 4, verse 1. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. Jesus, the word that has become flesh and dwelt amongst men, is led by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God led the word of God into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And this one, who is the devil, you shall also learn is I'll be teaching that he also claims to be a god of this world. So you may take it as God directed or influenced or led his son into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil inside the 40 days and 40 night fast. But you can never argue with the fact that Jesus is God. So God led God into the wilderness to be tempted. Now this is an encounter. This is an encounter between God and God. A reflection of God having an encounter with the Almighty God. And for 40 days and 40 nights, being tempted of the devil. And in those days, God did not eat anything. In those days, Jesus did not eat anything. And when those days had ended, Jesus, the Son of God, was hungry. And the devil, who claims to be the God of this world, said unto him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. The reason why the devil is saying, if you are the Son of God, is because when a God meets a God, they are able to know their ranks. They are able to know each other's ranks. So, this is a God that has summoned a God. When a God has summoned a God, that is an encounter of gods. So, he wants to see how much potential, how much proof do you have, how much capacity do you have to give me evidence that you are actually a god. Why? Because I, as Lucifer the devil that has fallen, I'm actually a god of this world. Now you, as the Son of God, and referring to Jesus, prove to me that you are a god, since you are saying you are the Son of God. And Jesus answered him and said, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. What Jesus has answered Lucifer there, it defines a god. Why? Because men shall live by bread indeed, but only gods can survive by the word. I hope someone is understanding what I'm saying here. Men shall not live by bread alone. When Jesus says men shall not live by bread alone, he defines the status of the word that became flesh. But that word that became flesh, it is also not just the flesh that was made by the word, but a God that became flesh. And a part of that flesh is man, and a part of that man is God. This is why Jesus is saying, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He references God in heaven, and he references another part of God that is him. And he references man because there was flesh in that God. That is the partition of man. And the devil has been given a response. But what is happening here? So that you may understand, the encounter that we have here is of God. It means God in heaven has allowed his other part to be driven into the wilderness to be tempted by a lesser God. And God wants to prove to God that you can conquer another level of a God. And God wants to prove that he can subdue another God. And God at this level is being challenged by God. There is he that claims to be a god. Why? Because he has been endorsed as a god of this world. I'm going to get to that part so that you understand that Lucifer was endorsed as a god of this world by God. And the devil taking him up into a high mountain, he shows Jesus all the kingdoms of the world in just a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power I'll give you and the glory of them. Why? Because it has been delivered unto me, and to whosoever I'll give at my own consent. What Lucifer is simply trying to say here is, everything that you're seeing Jesus here in this world, it has been given unto me. It is now entitled to me. And you're saying you're a god. You're a god from above. And you've come down here and you want to subdue this world. But first you have to go through me. Because down here, I call the shots. I'm the God of this world. So this brings us to an encounter of God versus God. And what Lucifer is simply trying to do here is subdue God. He's trying to subdue a God inside Jesus. Not the word that became flesh, but the God that is inside Jesus. The one that came from above. But can you subdue God? And what Jesus has to do here is to subdue the devil. When God encounters God, we have a situation of the exorcism of God. Lucifer, you want to practice an exorcism. You want to cast out God. You want to defeat God. You want to subdue God. You want to defeat God. The one that you are facing, he represents heaven and the earth. And the part of him that he has sent himself, it represents the one that will subdue the earth, representing heaven. And he says, all this has been given unto me. When he says all this has been given unto me, he's referencing that everything that you are seeing has been given unto me by who? By God. Meaning that God is calling the shots both in Lucifer and his son. Why? Because what Jesus has come to fight for, what Jesus has come to wrestle against, is Lucifer, who has been given power by the same God in heaven. Jesus, what you have to subdue inside Lucifer is the fact that Lucifer has also been given the potential powers, the potential capacity to run this world as a god. And in the process of battling against Lucifer, there is an exorcism of a certain god, and there is an exorcism of God that you are going to be conducting. You have to defeat the God that is inside Lucifer. And Lucifer, you also have to subdue the God that is in Jesus. God versus God. I hope someone is understanding what I'm saying here. Then Lucifer says, if therefore you will worship me, all this will be yours. But can God worship God? Can God worship to another God? Can gods worship each other? Let's wait and find out. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord thy God, and only him shall you serve. Which God? What Jesus is simply trying to tell Lucifer here is, there can only be one God. Yes, gods can battle. Yes, gods can wrestle. But at the end of the day, you cannot subdue the Almighty God. What Jesus is trying to show Lucifer here is that there is an ultimate God. What Jesus is trying to tell Lucifer here is that there can never be an exorcism of God unless God has exorcised himself. There is an exorcism that is impossible. The exorcism that is impossible is for you, Lucifer, to subdue God and God kneels down. What Lucifer wanted was Jesus to bow down and worship God. Which God? The God of this world. But there is the God that created the heavens and the earth. And if that happens, Lucifer, it means there will be an exorcism of God. And who has power to exorcise God except for God himself? And he says, get thee behind me, Satan. You shall worship the Lord thy God, and only him shall you save. Thou shalt worship. I shall worship, and you shall worship only one God. Yes, I'm a God from above. And yes, you are a God from underneath. But it is the Almighty God that represents heaven. And he brought Jesus to Jerusalem on the last temptation at the highest pinnacle of a temple. And he continues saying, if you are the Son of God, cast yourself all these tests. That Jesus is being given is that Lucifer wants Jesus to prove, are you God? Are you the Almighty God? Are you representing God? Are you representing the Almighty God? Because I'm a God down here. If you are the Almighty God, you are going to cast me out. And if you are not the Almighty God, then there is going to be the exorcism of God. But that exorcism of God, is it possible? Let's wait and find out. Lucifer is tempting Jesus from the highest pinnacle of the temple. And he's saying, throw yourself from this position. And all the angels, a legion of angels, certain angels, shall be sent and they shall save you. Isn't it that you are a God? Throw yourself in this position. And Jesus knows that by throwing himself, he would have tested his Father. He would have provoked his Father. Jesus knows that he is God, but the fullness of God is not here. For the fullness of God is above. I have my Father. That is the definition of the fullness of God. Yes, I'm a God. And I'm not going to throw myself at this position. It's very possible that if I throw myself at this position, angels might not rescue me. Why? Because there's the ultimate Father who represents the fullness of God. And even if he sends angels, he might disqualify me from the position of being a lesser reflection of God. And again, Jesus rebukes Satan. He rebukes Satan immediately and says, you shall not tempt the Lord thy God. Why is Jesus saying you shall not tempt the Lord thy God? He's referring to the God that is above, that is in him, and referring to Lucifer, not to tempt God. But who is the God? The God that is in Jesus is the same God that is in heaven. And afterwards, the devil ended all the temptations and he departed from God and left him for a season. Now listen to me. Jesus has conquered Lucifer, But after Jesus has conquered Lucifer, what has been happening here is that we were experiencing, we encountered a God fighting against a God. But what emerged at the end was that there is the Almighty God, an ultimate God who remains as God. Two gods battling against the other, but there is the Almighty God who cannot be exorcised. Can God be exorcised? No. The exorcism of God is impossible unless God is the exorcist. Child of God, I'm praying for you once again in this fifth segment, the exorcism of God. Only God is the deliverer. Only God is the exorcist. Only God is your true salvation. In the name of Jesus.
Jesus Christ.